Hello, I'm Peter Afrasiabi. I'm an intellectual property litigator at 1LLP. I litigate copyright, trademark, right of publicity disputes, soft IP. Today's program is exploring the world of intellectual property, soft intellectual property as it's known, copyright, trademark, right of publicity, by using Star Wars as a vehicle and petri dish to explore these issues. For you, the intellectual property lawyer, if you want to have a refresher, but also and particularly for the non-intellectual property lawyer who wants an overview of copyright, trademark, right of publicity law to understand the basics and precepts. And we get to do it in a fun, entertaining way by looking at the storied litigation history of Star Wars and exploring how these precepts play out. So, in the immortal speech pattern of Yoda, we have titled the program, Infringe, Do Not. Star Wars lessons in copyright, trademark, and an erotic film's fair use. We'll even be seeing some erotic films here, although you won't get to watch them, but you get to learn about them. So let's get started. Our topics today are copyright, where we'll do an overview of copyright, what it is, and the basics of infringement principles. We'll talk about fair use, and we'll look at fair use under copyright in terms of how the analysis is done, what are the factors, and we'll look at a couple Star Wars-related cases here, just as we look at a couple Star Wars-related cases on infringement, to understand the contours of fair use. That'll bring us to the erotic film. We're going to look at an overview of trademark law, what are trademarks, and then the basic infringement analysis and test that applies in the realm of trademark, and we'll see a couple Star Wars cases there again. We'll even see Star Wars taking on President Reagan there. We'll do an end, really, our third module is right of publicity, with a soft overview of right of publicity, a quick one. You want deeper programs? We have entire programs on dead celebrities devoted to right of publicity. But this will be a quick overview of right of publicity, and it's with a particular focus on modern technology in terms of how modern technology is really testing and pushing the right of publicity and bringing it more and more to the forefront as a very, very important right that needs to be, and will be litigated and seen more and more. And we will see in our final segment a fascinating use of modern technology and the right of publicity in a recent Star Wars movie, the fantastic Rogue One movie. Now, as I noted, for non-IP lawyers, this is a great entrance point if you want to do a survey program on the basics of intellectual property for your practice to understand the general overview of the law, the tests, how it works, where there's infringement pitfalls, and the like for copyright, trademark, right of publicity. And if you're an IP expert, you know it all. It's a great refresher course, and it's a fascinating way to use, if you're a huge Star Wars fan, the litigation and history of Star Wars to back into these fascinating questions. So let's get going. A long time ago in a galaxy not so far away, here in the US. So let's talk about copyright out of the gate. What things fall within the copyright realm? And you can see here on our slide a listing of the different things. We have books and music and film and photographs, artwork, source code even, architectural works, clothing designs, pantomimes, choreographs. And so for Star Wars, what's relevant, of course, are books. There you see one of the books. The music of Star Wars, and also video films, and then the characters depicted there who have copyright protection. And so these are the types of things that fall within the realm of copyright in terms of what a copyright could exist or inhere in. Let's start then with a copyright overview. What is copyright? Copyright exists for original works of expression that are fixed in a tangible medium. Copyright exists at the moment of creation. So if you're drawing a picture right now as you're listening to me speak, you're drawing someone in a lightsaber battle perhaps, or whatever it is you may be doodling, you're creating and you have a copyright right now at this moment of creation. Boom, you've already got a copyright out of this program. Pretty cool. It doesn't require registration or anything like that in order to have the copyright, although there are massive benefits to registering in terms of opening up a realm of damages and attorney's fees rights that you may not otherwise have if someone infringes your work that you haven't already registered. Copyright is 100% a federal law creature. It preempts all state laws within its space. It's got a very broad preemption reach. And so if you want to understand copyright, you're always understanding a creature of federal law litigated in federal courts. Let's talk, though, and briefly unpackage those two requirements. Originality first. Originality simply means it is original to the source. And courts do not get embroiled in the merits of artistic disputes. They just want to know that it was original to the source and it has the most minimal degree of creativity. And so the most recent quote, which picks up on very, very old case law in the United States, but this comes from Feist versus Rural, 499 U.S. 340 at page 345. This is in 1991. Minimal degree of creativity, extremely low. And so there you see there on the side, it's just a screenshot I took of the original screenplay written by George Lucas. The original title was, I guess, The Adventure of Luke Starkiller and taken from his Journal of the Wills by George Lucas. And so that's the type of thing that copyright inheres in. It's an original screenplay, an idea, and a story, and an adventure written by someone. Boom. That automatically applies because it's a low standard. We'll look on the next slide at a quote from Justice Holmes. And this is from the famed case of Bleistein versus Donaldson Lithographing Company at 188 U.S. 239, page 251 from 1903. And this is a basic statement of the law that we just saw from Feist, but it's the underlying policy that animates why there's a minimal creativity standard without much judicial analysis of it. It would be a dangerous undertaking for persons trained only to the law to constitute themselves final judges of the worth of pictorial illustrations outside of the narrowest and most obvious limits. At one extreme, some works of genius would be sure to miss appreciation. At the other end, copyright would be denied to pictures which appeal to a public less educated than the judge. And so the basic point Justice Holmes was making there, which courts have hewed to now for over 100 years, is that courts will not get embroiled in artistic merits questions as to whether what you created is of the requisite degree of creativity to merit copyright protection. It's just the type of thing that judges aren't trained in and would miss on both ends. And so courts really don't wade into it. So originality, pretty easy to hit that mark. The next element is fixation. And fixation requires that it actually be fixed in a tangible medium. And so what that means, that's copyright, federal copyright language speak for, in layman's terms, permanently record it in some manner. So you take pen to paper, you're doodling right now, you type on your typewriter, or in modern times you type on a keyboard and it goes into the operating system on the computer and that records it digitally. Drawings, you make a sculpture, you draw something, whatever it may be in there, of course. The act of George Lucas, who was literally sitting at a typewriter back in the day, obviously, was fixing his original expression in that tangible medium. The important point here is that if you've come up with the world's greatest haiku or poem for your loved one, and you have a sky writing person go out there and do it, you know, with those planes that blow smoke and write letters, you will not have fixed it in a permanent form, and so you will not have copyright protection at that moment in time, so you may want to write it down first. The massive line on our next slide that we're going to explore, and this brings us to our first cool Star Wars case, is the idea versus expression line in copyright. And this is a central dichotomy, really, in copyright. And the concept that sits beneath idea versus expression is the idea that ideas cannot be monopolized through the laws of copyright. And so general ideas don't get protection. The actual articulation of those ideas, the expression, can get protection. And so one way to think about it, in other words, is that Einstein wrote E equals mc squared, and I'm sure there was a bunch more complicated, you know, physics stuff behind it, of which I know nothing. But that was an idea of, you know, the, you know, energy equals mass times the speed of light and whatnot, and all that, the physics stuff, right? That is an idea. That's not subject to copyright protection. But the paper he wrote and published, you know, on the laws of thermodynamics or whatever the title of that paper was, I can't remember from physics in high school, I apologize. But that paper was an articulated expression of the idea. That paper had copyright protection. Someone couldn't reproduce, photocopy, transcribe, whatnot, without Albert Einstein's permission. And so we're going to explore this now first in a famous early Star Wars case of Ideal Toys versus Kenner Products. You can think of it as the case of the action figures. And so the basic facts are as follows. Star Wars has just been released. Kenner's releasing this line of Star Wars action figures, which obviously became immensely popular droids and heroes and villains and the like. And you see down there a picture at the bottom of our Darth Vader, C-3PO, and R2-D2 in their sort of action figure status. But the Ideal Toy Company releases its own line of space action figures under the name Star Team. And they had their Knight of Darkness, you can see there, their Zeroid Droid, and ZEM-21. Now, Kenner, who was making the Star Wars toys, was unhappy. And so they charged both copyright and trademark infringement. We'll talk about the trademark infringement aspect of this case a little bit later. But for now, copyright infringement. And they said, your three droids, you can see them there, or figures, are infringing our copyright and our figures of Darth Vader, C-3PO, and R2-D2. And the court concluded that the figures were too different to be charged with substantial similarity under copyright law, and we'll talk about that in a moment. But the core holding of the court is that they were built around similar themes and ideas, but that wasn't enough. And so here's the quote from the decision. The court has no doubt, and Ideal did not even deny, that Ideal sought to make use of the themes embodied in these three characters and in the movie itself. A theme is not protectable, however. It is only the idea which stands behind a protectable expression. And so what the court ultimately concluded from a copyright perspective is that Kenner, and ultimately Lucasfilm Star Wars, couldn't control other people releasing action figures of, you know, just space droids and, like, you know, villains dressed in black with black capes, unless they truly were knockoffs of Darth Vader, C-3PO, and R2-D2. And so this is a case coming out of the Southern District of New York. It's one of the earliest Star Wars cases, 1977, right when the film was released, at 443 F sub 291, page 306. And this idea, I give you here a software case. It's not a Star Wars case, but it's a software case that kind of gets at the same concept of this idea expression line, which is so central to copyright. Here, the Kepner versus Leadership software case involves software that was made for a very specific business model. And it was sort of a business model built around leadership questions, and then problems were posed, and then this would generate attributes to improve one's management decision-making, and this is all wrapped up in software. And so what the court held is that the questions themselves and the processes that the software did were unprotectable ideas. But the very specific wording employed by that software program was protectable expression. And so again, the concept here, the simplest way perhaps to think about it is that Microsoft Word, you cannot copy it and create a competitive program if you take its source code, lock, stock, and barrel, and copy it. But Google had every right to go create something built around the same idea and theme, that you have a word processing thing that allows you to type words, change the font, bold it, underline it, italicize it, and the like. That is an idea which is not protectable. The specific version of that idea would be protectable. And it may or may not give you enough protection because it can become a competitive space, obviously. But that's the idea expression concept. And that's our first case, Star Wars versus Star Teams. Star Wars loses battle number one. Now let's unpackage a little bit the substantial similarity test, because the question you get at then when you start comparing a copyrighted work to an alleged infringing work is, how do you assess whether they are similar enough or dissimilar enough? And there's an intrinsic test and an extrinsic test under copyright law. And the intrinsic test posits a subjective comparison that focuses whether the ordinary reasonable audience would find works substantially similar in the total concept and feel. At summary judgment, this test is really not assessed because this is ultimately a fact finder's test for jury. And so the test that tends to matter the most in litigation is the extrinsic test, because most of these cases do get resolved at summary judgment on the extrinsic test. And this is an objective test that looks at specific expressive elements and articulable similarities across those elements related to the creative works. And so before the comparison can be made, the court has to filter out unprotectable elements of the plaintiff's work. So in other words, ideas, concepts, public domain material, sans-faire, stock features that are commonly associated with some given subject matter. Those get filtered out by the court so that the court can compare what remains, i.e. the plaintiff's copyrightable copyrightable work, that can be compared to the defendant's work. And so at summary judgment, the extrinsic test is applied. On our next slide, you can see our extrinsic test for substantial similarity in the context this is of audiovisual works we're looking at here, since we're talking about Star Wars. And we're about to get to Star Wars versus Battlestar Galactica, so stay tuned. When we're looking at it in this space, the courts look at plot and sequence, theme, setting, the mood, the pace, dialogue, and the characters, and those, you know, character development, the traits, the relationships, and the nature of those characters. And so the courts will take these elements and compare them work to work to figure out if there is substantial similarity and infringement. So we are going to start with Star Wars versus Battlestar Galactica. And this is the case of 20th Century Fox versus MCA. It's reported in the Ninth Circuit at 715 F. Second 1327 from the Ninth Circuit 1983. And it basically involves one of the earliest pieces of litigation by Lucasfilm, where Lucasfilm sued the makers of Battlestar Galactica, saying that your characters, plot, relationship, everything of the movie Battlestar Galactica infringes on Star Wars. And so there you see a couple pictures from each of them where you can see the kind of the characters. And that the pictures are there to help, you know, you see who are these characters in each of the films and what the alleged articulable similarities were, at least between the characters who are in space and their relationships and the like. And so what the court did, it starts in the district court in California, and the court looked at those categories we talked about, theme, plot, characters, mood, setting, to assess whether there was a sufficient level of articulable similarities such that Battlestar Galactica could have infringed Star Wars. Now, I don't know if any of you have seen Battlestar Galactica, the movie. I'm sure you've all seen Star Wars. If you have seen both movies, you may well be scratching your head saying, no way does Battlestar Galactica infringe. That can't be true. But it was litigated. And so what the district court ultimately concluded is it looked at these things and it said, okay, we've got a theme of democratic forces against totalitarian forces. We have good against evil. We have a ceremony at the end. We have heroes and heroines being imprisoned. We have some sort of like non-human entertainment scenes going on. We have friendly robots. we have evil forces searching and good forces hiding and scenes cutting back and forth between the two. And so the district court looked at all of this and the district court concluded that they simply weren't substantially similar as a matter of law because too much was general themes and ideas and general plot sequences that were not protectable under copyright law. And that ultimately the district court concluded that yes, while both were space movies and there were robots and droids, they were so fundamentally different that to conclude infringement would to be in essence give a monopoly on something way beyond what Star Wars was to the genre almost of making star, you know, films about, you know, heroes and heroines and battles against robots and the like. But the case went to the Ninth Circuit, and the Ninth Circuit reversed. Now, on our next slide, captioned explanation of footnote 4, we understand why the Ninth Circuit reversed, which is to say it's very hard to understand because the case didn't really give an analysis. It's a published opinion, but all it really said is we reverse, and it dropped a footnote, and in the footnote it notes 13 similarities. And so you can read there those similarities, and they are at a very high level. Some of them are somewhat specific, but they are very, very general levels of similarities that could engraft onto all manner of films. And so the case is, to a large extent, ultimately one where it reversed and said, no, a jury could conclude that there's infringement. No jury ever concluded because the case didn't go to a jury. It ultimately resolved and settled. And factually, what had happened is by the time this case was being litigated, Battlestar Galactica as a TV series had kind of failed. It wasn't, succeeding in getting viewers and whatnot, and so it probably didn't matter anymore. But nonetheless, what matters for purposes of this opinion is that the Ninth Circuit said no, on the extrinsic test, a jury could conclude infringement because of these 13 similarities you see here, including like space vehicles are made to look old and worn out instead of looking new and sleek. And you have a climactic scene where the democratic forces take on the totalitarian forces. And then it ends in an award ceremony for the heroes of the Democratic forces, these types of things. So it's a pretty broad outlier opinion. I've done another program, if you're interested in really unpackaging substantial similarity, called From Star Wars to 6 Feet Under, where we really take apart this. And I can tell you from personal experience litigating these cases up to the Ninth Circuit, this is an outlier case. When you're on the side that you want to argue this case, despite arguing to the Ninth Circuit repeatedly and valiantly that this case should be cited and relied upon to justify cases going to the jury, the case doesn't get cited by the Ninth Circuit. I think it's recognized as being, well, an outlier, probably wrong, and this decision, in the immortal words of Star Wars, could be a decision from a long time ago in a legal galaxy far, far away. Now we're going to move. So that's that victory for Star Wars, by the way. Now we're going to move to another example of infringement, and we're going to look at the case of the Stormtrooper helmets. And this involves looking at copyright and sculptural works. And here we're dealing with a guy by the name of Ainsworth, who originally worked on the Star Wars as a 3D modeler. And he lives in the United Kingdom, lived there at the time, modeling the Stormtrooper helmets. And he developed these models for Lucasfilm. They made the helmets for the Stormtrooper actors, who then wore them in the films, obviously. Decades later, Ainsworth, had the original molds and also had some old helmets sitting around. And so his kid's tuition bill apparently was getting pretty big. And so he just sold some of these old helmets at an auction and was stunned at how much money he made. He realized, yikes, there's a market. There's all these rabid Star Wars fans out there who want Stormtrooper helmets, especially originals, right, from the original molds. So he started making and selling them. Lucasfilm is not happy, so they sue him in the Central District of California. He appears sort of in the beginning. He agrees to an extension of time to respond, but then he never responds to the complaint. Lucasfilm secures a default judgment of $20 million ultimately on a variety of claims on the theory, in part, that the helmet was copyrightable sculpture under the copyright law. Remember, we talked in the beginning about sculptures and artwork and paintings. They said, well, the helmet's a sculpture. It's copyright protected. They get a $20 million default judgment. They then go to the United Kingdom to register that judgment because they want to collect their money against Ainsworth, and really they want to stop him. I assume, given their wealth, really they wanted to stop him selling these Stormtrooper helmets so that they could have the market to sell Stormtrooper helmets themselves if they wanted. But in any event, they go there to the United Kingdom to take the battle to Mr. Ainsworth. And this brings us to our next slide, where UK copyright law strikes back. There you see a picture of, we saw Mr. Ainsworth before with his helmet. Now you can see his website selling the helmets for £249.99, Stormtrooper shop, selling armor, accessories, and the like. And so this works its way up to the Supreme Court in England, and the Supreme Court in England strikes back against US copyright law and says no. The Stormtrooper helmet is not a sculpture protectable under copyright law. And here we have some quotes from the decision. It was the Star Wars film that was the work of art that Mr. Lucas and his companies created. The helmet was utilitarian in the sense that it was an element in the process of production of the film. They analogized the Stormtrooper's helmet to a 20th century military helmet used in a war movie, finding the latter wouldn't be a sculpture, however great its contribution to the artistic effect of the finished film. And so fundamentally what the court held is that the helmet was utilitarian in nature fully. It was not a protectable sculpture. It was too utilitarian and served only a utilitarian function. Even if it was recognizable as the Stormtrooper armor and it had cachet and value and sex appeal and all that, it was fundamentally serving a utilitarian purpose as a costume and a prop in the film. And so the result was that they were unable to enforce the judgment there. And indeed, Ainsworth's business model then, at least in the United Kingdom, was blessed. And so if you go to his website now, you see he's extended beyond Stormtrooper helmets to other helmets from the Star Wars universe and props and whatnot that he makes. But nonetheless, there's a $20 million US judgment that presumably precludes him exporting and selling into the United States for violation of that judgment. But he apparently has a thriving Stormtrooper helmet business in the United Kingdom. So there we have one which sort of is a win and a loss for Star Wars, winning here, losing in the UK. I'm not sure who won the war or battle there. I'm thinking probably Mr. Ainsworth feels like he won the war there. Now let's talk about fair use. Fair use is a particularly central concept to copyright because it looks at that idea that we were talking about earlier about how much is too much in terms of copying. And so fair use starts from the copyright. It starts ultimately in our law, but we want to start with the copyright clause of the Constitution, which provides that it's to promote the progress of science and useful arts. That is a language that gives birth to copyright, but it necessarily gives birth also to fair use. Because to promote the progress of science and arts, we have to, on the one hand, protect our creators with the right to protect their works, but works are built upon other works. And so we have to allow new creators to build upon old themes and motifs and ideas to create new works and give them protection without allowing the original creator of a general idea absolute permanent monopoly protection. Star teams versus Star Wars, as we saw. Now, there's no textual provision for fair use in the Constitution, nor was there any textual provision in the original copyright acts at the Republic's founding, and indeed, up until 1976, it had never been codified. But it was part of the common law from England. And so we have here a quote from Justice Story. This is an 1841 case that talks about the common law doctrine of fair use to try to figure out when something is fair to do in terms of copying being acceptable. And so the quote is, "We look to the nature and object of the selections made, the quantity and value of the materials used, and the degree in which the use may prejudice the sale or diminish the profits or supersede the objects of the original work." That's the basic idea. And then fair use is codified in 1976. You see here on our next slide, it's at 17 U.S.C. 107. And it's a four-factor analysis that the court does. The court looks at the purpose and character of the use, the nature of the copyrighted work, the amount and substantiality of the portion used in relation to the copyrighted work as a whole, and then the effect of the use by the defendant upon the potential mark for or value of the copyrighted work itself. So let's unpackage really quick these fair use issues. We'll start by framing the problem. And you see here, we have another quote from Justice Story saying, "In truth, in literature, in science, and in art, there are and can be few, if any, things which in an abstract sense are strictly new and original throughout. Every book in literature, science, and art borrows and must necessarily borrow and use much which was well known and used before." And so the idea here is that we always are building upon the stock of prior things, borrowing and taking, and that's okay, and that also is something that has to breathe life into fair use. And you see here a quote from George Lucas himself talking about Star Wars, talking about how originally he was a fan of Flash Gordon in the serials and wanted to make a Flash Gordon movie, but he would have had to use characters he didn't want to do, and he wanted to take concepts and make something more original himself, something totally new. "I wanted to take ancient mythological motifs and update them. I wanted to have something totally free and fun, the way I remembered space fantasy." And you can read the full interview there at that link. Now, what I want to do right now is have you watch about a minute or so of a clip, and it's comparing the introductory crawl of Star Wars to the introductory crawl of old Flash Gordon film or television shows that George Lucas is talking about that he was building upon. And it's fascinating to look at, not just the idea of using a crawl, obviously, but even when you look at the language, as it pivots back and forth between the two, the general big picture motif and theme and story is itself emanating from the same universe, which goes to what Justice Story is talking about. There are certain numbers of themes and motifs that reside in literature and keep repeating, and people can create new original ones. But let's watch this really quick just to give you some insight into it. So there you have it. The question that's raised then is that, you know, when we're talking about the nature of creative efforts is we're able to borrow and adapt from prior ideas, but how much is too much? Obviously, what George Lucas did is perfectly fine. There's no infringement remotely of Flash Gordon. But there is borrowing of motifs and ideas. And so part of the subtle lesson, I think, from Star Wars, borrowing from Flash Gordon, is these ideas, fairy tales in space, technology, supplants the role of magic. We have heroes and villains, father and son stories, good and evil, tyranny, democracy, Flash Gordon, Julius Caesar, all reimagined in a completely original new way that's completely legitimate. Now, when we are looking at fair use, though, we look at those four factors. And just quickly, the first factor really looks at the purpose and character of the use, and nonprofit educational purposes are generally okay as opposed to commercial ones. But the central inquiry under the case law here in the modern era is whether the use is transformative or whether it's merely a reproduction. And fair use is more likely to be found when the original copyrighted work is transformed into something new or of new utility or meaning. Quotes in a paper or periodical works, as we're going to talk about momentarily. The second factor looks at the nature of the copyrighted work. And this factor focuses on the work being used, and the law grants for a wider or narrower scope of fair use depending upon the characteristics or attributes of the work. And so, for example, the unpublished nature of a work can weigh against defining a fair use because it hasn't yet been published, whereas the more broadly something is published and disseminated, the more this factor tends to then protect the defendant claiming fair use. Courts also, within this factor, tend to give greater protection to creative works, and so consequently, fair use applies more broadly to nonfiction rather than fiction. Courts are usually more protective of art, music, poetry, feature films, and other creative works than they may be of nonfiction works, i.e., if you write the history of the American Revolution as a sort of a textbook historical work for students, it's fact, it's history, you'll have copyright protection, but it'll be narrower and thinner because obviously other people can borrow and use those same facts to write their own version of history. That's fair use factor number two. Fair use factor number three looks at the amount or substantiality of the amount used. And so here what's important to understand is the law doesn't set quantity limits. And so one of the copyright myths out there is that it's okay to take 10% of something or one sentence or 10 words. And that's just a myth. It's not a quantitative analysis. It's generally true, however, that the more you use, the less likely you are within fair use. But you can't take refuge in saying you only used a little bit. It all depends what you took. So it's a quantitative and qualitative assessment. The famous case, of course, is the Gerald Ford memoirs case where, within this multi-hundred page book, there's one paragraph explaining why he pardoned Nixon, which, you know, by all accounts was about the most important part of the book and probably the only thing people wanted to read and understand at the time. And so when that one paragraph is lifted out and taken, it's not fair use, it's infringement, even though when that was done, the argument was made that it's quantitatively, 0.02%, but it was the most important 0.02%. And so that's an example of how courts deal with the amount taken. Fair use factor four looks at the effect on the potential market. And this is very, very complex. If you could have purchased or licensed the copyrighted work yourself, that tends to count against defining a fair use because by definition, you're impacting the work, the market of the work for your use. Now, this, of course, is extremely expansive and elastic and can almost swallow the concept of fair use back into creating what's a near, very broad monopoly by the original holder if we're not careful. If the effect is also linked to purpose, if the purpose is research or scholarship, the market effect can then be more difficult to prove. If the purpose is commercial, then it becomes easier to approve. That's the basic overview. So let's take this now to our first Star Wars case in the fair use world, and we're going to look at this case coming out of the fandom world. And here we're dealing with a defendant entity, and the case is Lucasfilm versus Ren Ventures, 2018 U.S. District Court Lexus 144116, Northern District of California 2018 is where it's reported. And this involves Ren Ventures, who made a mobile video card game called Sabacc. And Sabacc mimicked a fictional card game in the Star Wars universe from the movies and spinoffs. And so if you've seen Star Wars Han Solo, the movie, there's an ending scene there where Lando is playing Sabacc with Han Solo and Sabacc wins this card game and wins the Millennium Falcon and the rest is history. And there was some reference to it in one of the earlier movies or in some of the spinoffs and the like. And so Lucasfilm said, we're not okay with you having some digital video game, you know, called Sabacc, which is our mark, and in marketing their game, and this is sort of what obviously particularly upset Lucasfilm, they were using, you know, GIFs and quotes and commentaries from the Star Wars films and universe talking about this Sabacc game coming out of Star Wars. The defendant asserts fair use, saying it was a fair use to take this idea of a game from the movie, and then they created a real game here with its own rules of whatever they may be. And here's the fair use analysis. It was not transformative to simply take dialogue cropped out of the original movie, put it next to your video game. That was not a transformative use of the dialogue in those scenes and portions from the movie. However small they were, it wasn't transformative. It didn't lend new meaning to whatever that content was about Sabacc. On the second factor, the court said that these works obviously are highly expressive, but also widely published. And so similar quotes had also, the record showed, been taken and used all over the place in all manner of minimal uses throughout writings and literature in ways that were either deemed fair use, not deemed fair use, but just never litigated or contested. That factor then counted in favor of the defendant. The third factor was that it was a small use of a seconds-long clip that was quantitatively insignificant, and it wasn't even of the expressive core of Star Wars. So qualitatively, some little pendant reference to some card game or something within that genre wasn't really what Star Wars obviously was about. So the court said, it doesn't even really impact them that heavily in that way. And so that factor also tended to weigh in favor of fair use. And finally, on the fourth factor, while it's true that these GIFs were not a substitute for the film, they were done purely for a commercial profit motive to trade off the franchise value from the copyrighted works. And so that, of course, counsels against fair use. And so basically what you have here is a couple factors favoring fair use, the second and third factors, and then the first and fourth factors not favoring fair use. And those are the more important factors. And what district courts then do here is they get to balance these factors. And so the court ultimately, it's ultimately a question of law for the court. The underlying factual findings may be made by a jury if necessary, but the court gets to balance these factors. And the court balanced them and said, on balance, that is not fair use. And so this video Sabacc game from the Star Wars universe being put on by these people has gone the way of the dodo bird. And there below you can see Star Wars itself, Lucasfilm, Disney, and the folks today are selling their own card game called Sabacc, which is the official one you can play if you're into playing fictional card games in the real world now. Can't make it up. Case study two takes us to parodies and erotic films. And this is the film, the erotic film called Starballs. This is not to be confused with the 1980s Mel Brooks Spaceballs, which was itself a classic parody film. This instead is an erotic film, animated erotic film apparently, called Starballs. And there you see is a poster from the film. Because it's so X-rated, I have redacted a portion of the middle of the picture just so you don't see what's there, but given the location of the redaction, you can probably figure it out. But you can see there, it's a parody of Star Wars where you've got these characters and they're obviously engaged in sexual activity and it's apparently like an animated cartoon type porno movie. There he is holding a limp lightsaber, to put it mildly. And so in any event, they made this film and Lucasfilm was not happy. And so Lucasfilm sues the makers of this film. It's a Media Market Group. And so that's reported at 182 F/2nd 897. This comes out of the Second Circuit, the Northern District of California in 2002. And they're sued and they assert fair use as a parody. And what the court held, and here's a quote from the U.S. Supreme Court dealing with parodies in the seminal Two Live Crew case, Campbell versus Acuff Rose Music, 510 U.S. 569 at 580. And this is sort of the heart of fair use for transformative works. And that famous Two Live Crew case, of course, involved the Two Live Crew riffing on a Roy Orbison Pretty Woman song. The heart of any parodist's claim to quote from existing material is the use of some elements of a prior author's composition to create a new one that, at least in part, comments on the author's work. And so here then, applying these principles to Starballs, what the Northern District of California held is that Starballs was a parody of Star Wars in that it's a literary or artistic work that broadly mimics an author's characteristic style and holds it up to ridicule. And so the preliminary injunction that Lucasfilm sought was denied because the court concluded ultimately that this was parodical in nature and so would ultimately likely be a fair use. So the film could not be shut down. Now, an important tip here. It's very important not to confuse parody with satire. Parody is highly protected as fair use because parodies by nature use the original work as a comedic or transformative commentary on the work itself. And so in order to do that, you have to use the very work to comment on the work. There's a line, though, between parody and satire. Satire is different. Satire offers criticism about the world in general by borrowing and using a work to come up with a creative way to make that satirical point about the world. And so satire is more restricted because satire can stand alone without borrowing. If you want to make a comment about the state of the world, you don't need to use Star Wars to do it, even if you can use Star Wars in a creative way to poke fun at what we're doing in modern politics, for example. Because satire can stand alone, you don't actually have to borrow from it. And so this is a critical line in copyright fair use that often gets lost on parties thinking what they're doing is using a work and they would have fair use because they see it as a parody, when it's not really a parody, it's a satire. And courts do wade into assessing the difference between parody and satire. But for the Starballs, just like for Mel Brooks' Spaceballs in the 1980s, clear parodies, clear fair use under the law. And so that's a victory, not for Star Wars, but for the prodigal filmmakers. Now, from Star Wars erotic films and copyright, we're going to shift to our second module, which is trademark. And the first question is, what is a trademark? The common synonym for the concept of trademark is a brand. Star Wars, your brand. Coke, 7-Up, Chevy, Google. So they can be words, sounds, numbers, combinations, shapes, smells, all manner of things can be a trademark because they must connote a given company's goods or services, a source. And as a source identifier, they gain what's known as trademark protection. Now, technically, when it's applicable to goods, like your watch, your suit, whatever it may be, your telephone, it's known as a trademark. And when it applies to services, such as what all of us do, our law firms, my law firm, one LLP, that name is trademarked. It's what's known as a service mark, or Citibank for banking, Saks for clothing. Now, it even extends to product packaging and certain non-functional product configuration features, and that's what's known as trade dress, which is a fascinating world in terms of protecting non-functional look and feel of products. And if you want to explore that in more detail, we have a fascinating program called Ford versus Ferrari, looking at trade dress in automobiles to understand exactly how trade dress works. But back to the realm of Star Wars, let's talk on our next slide about the categories of marks on the trademark spectrum. And we're going to look at marks that go from no protection to the most protection. On the no protection end of the spectrum, we have generic. And these are simply common names for products that are used by many. And if it's a common name used by many, it doesn't get protection. Like National Bank for a bank, or light to connote low calorie. You can't monopolize those words at all. They're generic. The next step up from generic is descriptive. And a descriptive mark is one that conveys an immediate idea of the qualities, characteristics, ingredients of the goods. And here it may have protection if secondary meaning is shown, and that exists where it's become associated with a single commercial source in the minds of the consumers due to its extensive systematic use. And so, for example, you can think of baby brie for cheese, honey baked for ham, vision center for optics clinics. Those are not generic. There's a line between generic and descriptive, but they are descriptive, and so they can then acquire trademark protection if they end up having the requisite amount of use for secondary meaning. Next is a suggestive mark, and that's inherently distinctive and has protection, just like our final category, arbitrary. A suggestive term echoes some aspect of the product or service, but the connection is not immediate, and it requires some sort of mental leap, imagination, perception to connect it to the product. And so you could think of contact for adhesive paper. It's not descriptive at all, but with one leap of mental logic, you can understand the connection between contact, adhesive paper. Playboy, men's magazines, right? Not immediately descriptive, but it's suggestive. Q-tips for cotton swabs. Or perhaps if you were a law firm, you may call yourself Sentinel Intellectual Property. It's suggestive of protecting, and IP protects people, that kind of suggestive, that type of a thing. Now, the most protected category in terms of sort of just being absolutely inherently distinctive and getting the broadest kind of protection under trademark law when it comes to the litigation analysis is the arbitrary fanciful mark. And that's simply an arbitrary use of a word in an unfamiliar way. So, camel for cigarettes. There's just no connection whatsoever. It's arbitrary. Ivory for soap. Google for search. On the next slide, we have trademark infringement. And the basic test, it's not like the substantial similarity test we talked about in copyright. Here, the basic test to figure out whether someone's infringing your trademark is what's known as the likelihood of confusion analysis, likelihood of consumer confusion. And the courts, to figure out if there's this type of confusion, look at several factors. And it's basically the same test across all the circuits in the US, and they look at the following factors. The strength of the mark, and we just looked at that category. You know, is it on the low end, descriptive, is it on the high end, arbitrary? The degree of similarity, the good faith of the defendant, or the intent of the defendant, the bad faith. Is there evidence of actual confusion in the marketplace? How sophisticated is the market in purchasing? I.e., you know, if it's something you pick up out at the checkout stand in the grocery store, like a pack of gum that you just pick up on the way out, you throw in your cart, there's less, and it's cheap, there's less kind of sophistication in terms of the purchase. But if you're buying a Ferrari, there's far more sophistication in terms of the purchase and far less likelihood of being confused, right? That's that factor. And then the quality differential is generally looked at too. So from there, let's get back into our Star Wars universe, and we're gonna look at our first trademark case. And this is the case of Star Wars versus the New York Jedi Schools. This is the case of Lucasfilm versus Brown, 2018 U.S. District Court Lexus 16305 from the Northern District of California, again in 2018. And this is a case where, believe it or not, someone in New York opened a business offering lightsaber classes to improve your Jedi skills. And these were lightsaber choreo classes. I couldn't find you a video of what happened in these classes, although I am fascinated to know. I'm imagining it, given reading the opinion, to be something like you have a lightsaber and you're doing some form of martial arts or swordsmanship in some sort of exercise class where you are being trained to be a Jedi. And apparel was offered. And our bottom picture here, you can see the apparel was offered with a logo. And you can see the defendant's logo on the left. And you can see a logo that Lucasfilm has trademarked with the U.S. Trademark Office of an actual Star Wars logo. And this is, I guess, this the logo of coming out of like Jedis or the Rebels they wear on their helmets and whatnot. In the movies, you'll notice that logo. And so that's been trademarked. On top of that, apparel was being offered with these logos, and the defendant receives a cease and desist letter, and the next day files a federal trademark application for martial arts instruction, and you see there the federal trademark that was applied for this Jedi school, where we could all become Jedis, I guess, called New York Jedi, and there you've got the Statue of Liberty holding up a lightsaber. In any event, Lucasfilm was not amused and filed suit. There was a confidential settlement. Don't know what it is, obviously, because it's confidential, but the suit was dismissed. The business no longer exists. At least I wasn't able to find it in existence anymore, so sorry you can't get an unofficial Jedi certificate. Not sure you can even get an official one. And in checking the trademark database at the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office, the trademark for our New York Jedi entity was canceled. So that's an example of victory for Star Wars in an infringement question in terms of that likelihood of confusion analysis. And the basic analysis runs that it's a strong mark, you know, Jedis and those logos, it's just sort of arbitrary and it's all related to Star Wars, a high degree of similarity. No good faith was found because it was something that was trading off of the Star Wars universe in order to build this martial arts lightsaber sorting business or whatnot. They were using Star Wars and associating themselves with Star Wars and Star Wars intellectual property to build that business. And that's exactly the type of thing that creates a likelihood of confusion under that analysis we looked at before. And it was not authorized, obviously. And so victory for Star Wars. Now we're going to look at another case. And this is when Star Wars took on President Reagan. For those of us who grew up in the 80s or were around in the 80s, we'll remember President Reagan's SDI program, the Strategic Defense Initiative. And there we have a rendering of what was this program that was controversial in the 1980s. And it was a national government program designed to build some sort of technology in space such that we could be protected by having weapons up in space that would be able to shoot down incoming nuclear missiles if launched by the Soviets and blow them up before they reached us. And so this SDI program became known as Star Wars. We're in the 1980s, it's space technology, we're in the era of the Star Wars movies, and so it just became known as the Star Wars program. And at the time, it was political and very controversial technology-wise, that is, as to whether building something like this would actually protect us or would it actually augment the chances of a nuclear war. So it's a very politicized issue. In any event, there were various groups that were then referring to the SDI program as Star Wars, different lobbying groups and other organizations on each side of the controversy. And so Lucasfilm files a lawsuit against all of them, basically saying that they were infringing Lucasfilm's trademark in Star Wars, the mark, by using that term in political advertisements, political discussion and lingo, and Lucasfilm sought an injunction to cease calling President Reagan's program, colloquially, Star Wars. The district court, and this is in the District of Columbia, and you see at the bottom there our case citation, Lucasfilm versus High Frontier. It's reported at 622 F sup 931, and this is 1985. What the district court held is that Lucasfilm did not have a property right in the word Star Wars beyond its use as a denoter of goods and services, a trademark. And this is a very, very important principle of trademark law. You don't own the words to the exclusion of everyone else. You own them as a trademark to the exclusion of other people using them to denote goods and services in competition with you or in damage to you and your mark. And so what the district court held is that the use by others in speech of Star Wars and referring to this space program as a Star Wars program was not in competition and was not a trademark use. And here's the quote from our district judge. Courts obviously cannot regulate the type of descriptive, non-trade use involved here without becoming the monitor of the spoken or written English language. And that's an important quote because what basically the court's saying is that there's no way that use by lobbying groups as referring to President Reagan's SDI and political speech was in any way creating confusion as to Lucasfilm's association with SDI. In other words, the idea that the consuming public somehow thought that Lucasfilm and George Lucas was sponsoring President Reagan's, national nuclear SDI program was meritless, and it was not a trademark use of the words, and courts are not going to grant that kind of a monopoly in the language. And so it was simply a case of overreach by Lucasfilm. And the final quote from the court here is that plaintiffs in the difficult position of objecting, because what he has depicted as fantasy may be frightening when depicted as a potential reality. Plaintiff must be left to his own devices to maintain the strength of his trademark by making the differentiation clear and convincing. So, loss for Star Wars there. Win for President Reagan in the trademark battles. This brings us to episode 2, Star Wars versus Star Team. We saw in the beginning in the copyright section, the Star Team versus Star Wars copyright analysis, but there was also a trademark claim. And so now we're gonna go back to our action figures and we're gonna look at what happened on the trademark front. Because here, Star Wars contended that Star Team was infringing the trademark. We have Star Wars, we have Star Team. And so what the court held here is that the trade names were different and that there was no basis to think that Star Wars fans would ever think that Star Team's figures, which had nothing to do with the movies, they weren't in the movies, they weren't characters from the movies, were somehow affiliated with a movie, but they were never in. And what the court found most interesting is that the Star Team's characters were sold along with a comic book, which was sort of the medium in which stories about these characters existed. And this comic book had been produced by the Ideal Company in conjunction with the toys and given away with the toys. And the story told in the comic book and the personality of the toys in the comic book was completely different from the characters of Star Wars. Basically, these Star Teams people, these droids, Zeroids and ZEM-21, were in a head-to-head battle taking on the Knight of Darkness himself, which is just completely different to sort of what the characters were doing in Star Wars in terms of the droids were victims of Darth Vader and weren't in head-to-head battle with Darth Vader. And so here's an important point that the court made, and that is that a finding of general association that the toys look like the movie or remind someone of the movie does not mean that the prospective purchaser thinks that the toys are derived from the movie or sponsored by the movie. This is an incredibly important point that weaves throughout that analysis we talked about, the likelihood of confusion analysis, in terms of animating the decision maker in cases. And it's a statement of the law that you see over and over and over again. Here it's applied to Star Wars. But general association is not enough. Because two things may be correlated or associated in some way, that in no way establishes that people actually think that they're sponsored, in fact, by the movie, or that Lucasfilm was somehow behind this Star Team thing going on. So, loss on the trademark front also for Star Wars, and so in our first IP litigation battle coming out of the Star Wars world, Star Wars was the resounding loser. Finally, we're going to shift to right of publicity now, and we're going to do a quick overview of the right of publicity before we look at a couple fun clips dealing with modern technology and the right of publicity. The right of publicity is the final leg of our soft IP world that we're going to talk about today. And this is a statutory or common law right in many states, but not all. It's currently in around 35 states. And this is an intellectual property right that inheres in us as individuals to protect against someone else's unauthorized use of our name, image, likeness, voice. And the root right here is that the right that we all have as individuals to control the commercial use of our identity. It can last from 10 to 100 years post-mortem in some jurisdictions, and it lasts post-mortem in some jurisdictions depending upon whether when you died you were famous. In other words, I'm not going to have a right of publicity post-mortem because I'm not a celebrity, but celebrities do. Dead celebrities, known as delebs is the lingo in the case law, and it can range up to 100 years. Different states have different rules in terms of how this applies. Some states have registration regimes, some states don't. There's a broad range of rights that vary in the states to making a jurisdictional pick very, very important. But that's the sort of the big picture right of publicity overview. And you start there, as you see, with a picture of the famous English actor Peter Cushing, who played the Grand Moff Tarkin, one of Darth Vader's henchmen in the Star Wars movies, the guy who was running the Death Star and blowing up planets and the like. And we have a picture of him there because we are going to see his appearance in a later Star Wars movie decades after he died, raising right of publicity questions. But real quick, just as an overview, let's take California as a prototypical example of the right of publicity. And California has a statutory right at California Civil Code 3344, protecting against these unauthorized uses, where we have to figure out if there's a knowing use of someone's identity for advertising purposes or commercial purposes. And if there is, then you can shut it down and stop it. Now, I don't have a litigation case involving Star Wars and the right of publicity to give you, but I can get close because on the next slide, we're going to look at robots. It's a Vanna White robot, but it's still a robot, just like a sort of a droid from Star Wars. And this is the famous Vanna White robot case called White versus Samsung, 971 F second 1395 from the Ninth Circuit in 1992. And here we have a Samsung ad that was made depicting a robot in a wig and jewelry turning this Wheel of Fortune board. And it was presented to resemble, her selling, Samsung stuff. And so Vanna White sues under California right of publicity law. Case goes up to the Ninth Circuit, and the Ninth Circuit holds in favor of Vanna White. And here's the quote. Television and other media create marketable celebrity identity value. Considerable energy and ingenuity are expended by those who have achieved celebrity value to exploit it for profit. The law protects a celebrity's sole right to exploit the value, whether the celebrity has achieved her fame out of rare ability, dumb luck, or as a combination thereof. Because White has alleged facts showing that Samsung and Deutsch had appropriated her identity, the district court erred by rejecting on summary judgment White's common law right of publicity claim. So the point there, you see in the picture, that robot is instantly evocative of Vanna White's likeness, her image, her persona, her personhood. And so that's why Samsung lost and Vanna White won. So now let's look at modern technology quickly. And I've done other programs on sex law and right of publicity, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, a program on the metaverse where we've talked about this. But modern technology in the sex space has created sex dolls, which are very, very human-like and becoming more and more human-like all the time in this whole world of artificial intelligence and dolls and the like. And there we have a picture of a sex doll, and this is a reported case where a Chinese company made this sex doll, and it resembled a very famous young Israeli internet influencer and named even the doll with the same name as her. And so that's an example of a use of her right of publicity to make a sex doll of all things. And that's an example of modern technology. Another example of modern technology, bringing us back to video, and we're about to get back to Peter Cushing, is deep fake videos. And so here, I want you to watch for the next 45 seconds this deep fake video made of Tom Cruise. Here you go.
That's why.
Oh.
It's a little embarrassing, you know. It reminds me, it was once in Russia, I ran into Gorbachev. He said,
"You know, Mr. Movie Star, are you nervous?"
I said, "No, Mr. Gorbachev, I'm not nervous, I don't."
He goes, "Well, remember how much a polar bear weighs."
I said, "Polar bear?"
He said, "Enough to break the ice."
It's the last time I've ever seen Mikhail Gorbachev. What's up, TikTok?
Okay, that was Tom Cruise. Oh, I swear that was Tom Cruise myself, but it wasn't. It's a deep fake video. It shows you how profoundly powerful this technology is, and it engrafts onto the right of publicity. And so what these technology examples show is that the right of publicity itself is becoming an intellectual property right that is becoming easier and easier to infringe in new and very dangerous and deceptive and unfair ways. That's a funny clip, obviously, of Tom Cruise, but my goodness, you'd swear up and down it's Tom Cruise. So this brings us to right of publicity in the digital age of films, and we're now back to Peter Cushing, to the fantastic Star Wars film Rogue One. If you haven't seen it, that's my plug for Star Wars, Rogue One. Loved it. This is a use of his likeness and voice. And it's not a use of old footage, which is a very different question. So they took his voice and his likeness and put him in new scenes and just created new scenes with this character, Moff Tarkin, being performed by someone else physically. But this face of Peter Cushing is put there and his voice with completely new dialogue and scenes. This raises right of publicity's questions. And so watch for a minute this fantastic video showing you the original, the new digital, and the morphing of the two and how they're created.
When has become now, Director Krennic, the Emperor will tolerate no further delay. Failure will find you explaining why to a far less patient audience.
If saying it would only make it so. That won't be necessary. We need a statement, not a manifesto.
You have made Time an ally of the rebellion.
I will tell him that I will be taking control over the weapon I first spoke of years ago, effective immediately.
Sir, shall I begin targeting their fleet?
Lord Vader will handle the fleet. You may fire when ready.
Regional governors now have direct control over their territories. Fear will keep the local systems in line. Fear of this battle station.
And what of the rebellion?
Enough of this. Vader, release him.
This bickering is pointless. Not after we demonstrate the power of this station. In a way, you have determined the choice of the planet that will be destroyed first. I grow tired of asking this, so it'll be the last time. Where is the rebel base?
You may fire when ready.
What?
You're far too trusting. You may fire when ready.
there you have it. That is a use of Peter Cushing's voice, his image, and his likeness. Now, this was licensed, so obviously Disney and the like didn't infringe. They licensed it from the estate. But note what's very interesting. The United Kingdom does not have a post-mortem right of publicity. So could they have just done it? Open question. Probably not for this reason. Many U.S. jurisdictions allow post-mortem rights of celebrity to dead celebrities, even if you are never domiciled in the state. They're hyper-expansive in order to be hyper-protective of dead celebrities and give those states great forums to litigate in. So licensing is always the safest approach if you're ever thinking that you're going to go dig up a dead celebrity and use his voice or likeness for a commercial endeavor to help your client sell their products. Don't do it. Go get a license. Spoiler alert. At the very, very end of Rogue One, there's another fantastic scene with another use of right of publicity licensed with another deceased celebrity. I won't ruin it for you. If you haven't seen the movie, go see the movie. This brings us to our conclusion today. And you guessed it, I'm not going to read you the conclusion. I'm going to let you watch a fantastic crawl in the echo of Star Wars. Thank you for watching today. As always, if you have any questions, reach out to me. And here are your conclusions.